What's up, everybody, and welcome back to another match from the GMPGL, brought to you by yours truly, B-Bon, and I have the great pleasure to bring you a match between Mineski, the fan favorites from the Filipino scene. Even though they've been in a recent slump, they have nothing else to qualify for in regards to Dota 2, so they will be playing Dota 1 for the foreseeable future. At least that's how I am thinking that it will be. Although they could make a switch, they do have another team headed by Mr. Switch that will be playing Dota 2. And on the Scourge side, we have Ledion's TurboRatz. So I guess Ledion is a pretty big sponsor in the Southeast Asian Dota scene. They have two teams, Ledion Dreams and Ledion TurboRatz. Ledion Dreams, of course, being captained by Jules. And hopefully I can get the Jay versus Jules show match shown up if the replays are released. And that would be a pleasure to bring it to you all. But right now, we have a recommended replay from GhostGamers.net, so that means a couple things. One, it means this game is going to be long, because Southeast Asian Dota 1 games are always long if they're recommended replays. Two, that is either going to be really magnificent team play, or a shit ton of kills. And my bet is on the latter. Of course, that doesn't mean that, you know, having a shit ton of kills doesn't negate the fact that there might be magnificent team play, but we all know that Southeast Asian Dota 1 replays are bloodbaths if they are recommended replays. So let's see how it goes. We got Naka Siren, Lycanthrope, going to be the first two bans by Mineski. And we're going to see an Omni-Knight ban by Ledion. Maybe that's because Mineski is a strong Omni-Knight player, although I have not seen them run Omni-Knight very recently. Maybe they, Mineski that is, picked up Omni-Knight recently in the GST or in the first couple matches of the GMPGL. Remember, this is a LAN tournament, so I'm sure teams have been discussing strategies amongst themselves. I'm sure they're all very, very good friends, even if they are competitors. So maybe they're sharing some strategies in that regard. But Earthshaker and Templar Assassin are going to receive the Banhammer as well. So that means probably not going to see an Ancient Apparition pick unless we get another long-range stunner support in a tri-lane. Or we might see the Ancient Apparition pick solely on the back of the Ice West. But Earthshaker and Ancient Apparition are such stable components of a tri-lane that protects the carry that it will be very, very odd to see an Ancient Apparition not being paired up with the Earthshaker. And indeed, we see a Shaodan being the first pickup by Ledion TurboRatz. Meanwhile, Queen of Pain is the last banned by Mineski, so we're not going to see Queen of Pain in Southeast Asian Dota 1 match. What is the Sorcy? So a couple heroes still left in the pool. There is Chaos Knight, there's Panda. There is Bat, even though we haven't seen Bat too often recently in regards to the Southeast Asian Dota 1 scene. I'd be really interested in getting some Chinese Dota 1 replays, but unfortunately they do not release them. All their profits are made by the streams and watching the VODs, so you can't really blame them because that is what's keeping the Dota 1 scene alive in China at the moment. So we're going to see a Sand King and Winner being picked up by Mineski, and hopefully the Sand King will receive either the farm in the lane or will be soloing lane, because you all know my thoughts on a supportive Sand King in a tri-lane. A supportive Sand King in dual lane is fine, at least it gets experience. A supportive Sand King in a tri-lane is really, really not very good, especially if that Sand King decides to roam with Smoke and Deceits and all that jazz, because, hey, he doesn't have a very long-range stun, it doesn't have the longest duration in regards to other stuns. He needs a lot of levels for Epicenter to work out, he needs a good amount of farm so he can pick up a dagger, because as you approach the late game, even though the slow goes through BKB, I mean, the Sand King Epicenter will just be more and more ineffective as time goes on, as teams pick up Mechanism, Pipe, and just sort of outlast that Sand King ultimate. And without that ultimate, what can Sand King really do in a teamfight? I guess he can right-click. And that's pretty much it. Anyway, Windrunner, of course, y'all know my feelings on this hero. Ridiculously annoying that she's in every single game since June 2010. Probably even back further if, you know, there were some replays. Probably May 2010. Or ever since Ice Frog fixed her Shackle Shot so that it worked properly and that it can latch on trees, she's been in the competitive scene just because Shackle Shot, one of the most game-breaking non-ultimate stunts in the game. 12-second cooldown, a double hex potentially. Even though Fissure is more reliable in the early game, once you level up a Shackle Shot, there's very few spells in the game that can just completely own a team fight, provide a safe avenue for initiation, and just go on a tear. We're going to see a Dragon Knight and a Puck being picked up by Ledion TurboRatz. So Puck, we've been seeing a little bit more often, and I'm really liking how Puck is making a resurgence, just because I think he fits the Filipino playstyle so effectively. he gets a fast blink dagger, or he gets a blink dagger around 20 minutes. Even if it's not that fast, he bottle crows it up, which Puck really needs the mana so he can do that. And Puck, of course, with the illusory orb, combined with the winning of silence, blinking in. And if there's one thing that Pinoys love to do, it's that they love their spells. They love to just cast as many spells as possible, and just get as many kills as possible. So Puck having that silence and having them held in place with the Dream Call, because Pinoys often pick very mobile heroes, holding people in place with the Dream Call, getting them disabled with the waning grip silence for 3 seconds is such a huge boon in the team fight that we've seen a lot of success with Puck in the past couple of games on my channel. And yes, you can keep up with my channel. I will still be bringing you Dota 1. I think I'm the only one from DC who still brings you regularly Dota 1 replays, so be on up to date with that. And of course, I will be bringing you Dota 2 replays as well as I get them, so be on lookout for that. Meanwhile, it looks like Ledion may left Invoker to the banning phase for the third pick for Mineski. We're going to see Slaughter and Rubick being picked up. I expect Invoker to solo mid, and if we're going to see a solo mid Invoker, I expect Jay to be playing that Invoker for Mineski. Jay's Invoker is pretty solid. I haven't honestly not seen him in action too many times, even though I've casted a crap ton of Mineski games. But hopefully his Invoker will be extremely impressive. I'll be interested to see if he goes for Exort or if he goes for the Quaswex build. It's not really standard Quaswex anymore because teams have been changing it up quite frequently these days. We're going to see a Chen being banned by Ledion Dreams. I like this ban just because it limits some of the jungling options that Mineski could have, and it forces the Sand King to pick a side, whether he's going to be in the tryline and whether he's going to be pretty useless in the mid-late stages of the game, or if Sand King will be stuck in a dual lane, and will they pick up an Enchantress? We're going to see Weaver probably, because Mineski RR says, hey, let's pick up a Weaver, guys. He's a pretty good carry sometimes. But recently that has not been the case. Weaver wins very, very infrequently, so it's going to be interesting to see how this shapes up. Weaver, of course, is a very survival hero who can get very extremely deadly in the late stages of the game, but he requires so much farm. He requires damage, he requires tank, he requires like Lincoln Spear or BKB, something so he doesn't get chain stunned, just get completely owned, and requires at least 2 to 3 damage items before he comes pretty much an unstoppable carry. But when he does get to that, he's really, really difficult to handle. We're going to see a Kunkka being picked up by Ledion.TurboRatz. Kunkka, of course, being paired with a Shadow Demon, although I haven't seen Kunkka win with this setup, but hopefully Ledion.TurboRatz can turn this game around. We're going to see a Centaur ban by Mineski. Centaur saw some play, but I'm not really too sure what the purpose of that is. Even though they have a Dragonite, I guess they want Centaur just to eliminate the possibility of a pretty deadly tryline combination, because Centaur does land quite nicely with the tryline because of his double nuke spells and his AoE stomp. Going to see Weaver being picked up by a Mineski RR, and looks like we're going to see a Crystal Maiden being picked up by the last pick. We do see them in the all chat. Let's just check if there is an observer chat. No, there's no observer chat, so we cannot check out the farm very easily, so that's going to be pretty annoying. I'm going to have to turn off Fog of War for now, and so we're not going to be able to check out how the carries are farming, but hopefully we'll be able to see, based on the item progression, based on the number of kills and lack thereof, based on whether the carries are jungling or not, how good the farm and how well the opposing team is farming. But right now, it's going to be non-observer vision, a little bit annoying, but hey, you know, the Southeast Asians are doing a good job of always having an observer slot. So, unfortunately, in this game, we're not going to see that. We're going to see an Ogre Magi being picked up by the last pick of Ledion.TurboRatz. Ogre Magi saw a little bit of play in Dota 2. I'm sure he's a fringe pick, just like he was in Dota 1. But he's a very tanky support hero who scales pretty nicely with the late game, just because he can get off a ridiculous nuke with a decently duration stun. And, of course, the Bloodlust just scales magnificently into the late game. So just introducing the players and the teams. Mineski on the Scourge side. Jay is going to be playing that Invoker. We have RR playing the Windrunner. ASD, aka Nando, the Child Prodigy, playing the Windrunner. 716 playing the Weaver, who I think is Oa, or Woots, or something like that. And we have CMW playing the Sand King. Meanwhile, on the Scourge, I have not had the privilege of casting a Ledion.TurboRatz game, so hopefully we'll see how this shapes up. We have RJ playing the Puck. Gonna see 143 playing the Ogre Magi. Gonna be seeing Lei K on the Kunkka. Also Akida playing the Shadow Demon. And last but not least, we're gonna have CI Heart playing the Dragon Knight, so we'll just call him Heart or Dragon Knight, whatever fits my fancy in this regard. Alright, you're gonna see a very offensive Observer Ward being placed down just to scout the lane. Gonna see a couple of Chainstorms. Unfortunately, the Torrent does miss. The Fire Blast does manage to hit, but Ogre Magi is gonna be focused on a little bit, but he's very, very tanky. Might not even have to pop a Tango, but he's gonna do it anyway. He has a couple of Clarities. Looks like he was given a Clarity by one of his teammates just to bring up his mana to speed. The Torrent did miss, but Kunkka and Shao Demon in this trial and will be pretty potent. Gonna be very survivable disruption, Ogre Magi being a naturally tank support. Of course, one of the difficulties they'll have will just be in regards to harassing, as Skin King escapes once again with the Burrow Strike, but right now he's in a lot of trouble. Nice blocking by the Kunkka player, Lei. He might get one more hit up on the Sand King. Here comes the Shao Demon auto attack. Can Kunkka get into range? Does Ogre have enough mana for the Fire Blast? He does not, but looks like Kunkka manages to pick up the last hit. Lei Ki manages to pick up the first blood, so he's gonna be very content with that, pick up the Ring of Basilius, and be able to handle this lane. So we are gonna see a Sand King in the trial lane. Not a huge fan of that. Sand King will become pretty useless because Weaver will have to get the bulk of the farm. And Crystal Maiden, I mean, she doesn't need too much experience, but you like to get her some experience in the trial line. So right now, Sand King is going to be not having a good time. Already gave up first blood to place the Observer Ward. So meanwhile, Invoker versus Dragonite. Invoker should handle this lane quite easily, especially since he picked up Exhort. Just going to be able to outlast hit the Dragonite. Dragonite does not have the highest base damage. I mean, he did pick up a Quelling Blade, but that's going to limit how fast he can pick up his Bottle Courier. And you all know how much the Filipinos love to Bottle Crew up with Dragonite in the middle lane. But still, Exhort, he's going to be pretty careful once Dragonite does pick up the Bottle Courier, just because Exhort build does not give you the most amount of regen. Let's just check out. He does have 6 Tangos, so he might just go stable with the Exhort build, rather than pick up some points in the Quas. We'll have to see what build he decides to go for. But Jay, a pretty confident mid-solo player, if he does not go all out balls deep and go just suicidal for a bunch of kills. Meanwhile, Puck versus Windrunner. Windrunner should have the advantage. Better attack animation, better base damage, and a more spammable nuke with a larger mana pool to do it with. And the nuke is a little bit more difficult to dodge, although Puck can eliminate some of the rest just because of that 0 mana cost phase shift, allowing him to keep into the lane for quite a long time. But Puck should be okay once he picks up the bottle and starts spamming that illusory orb to get last hits. But right now he's getting bullied to heck by this Windrunner player, ignoring all the creeps, just casting Windrun offensively as well just to avoid some of the hits. Might be able to pick up a kill. Illusory orb already casted, but it looks like Puck will be able to escape. No salve, so he'll have to back up, play very conservatively for quite a bit of time. But Windrunner is controlling the lane extremely competently, so Puck is going to have to be careful. But Illusory Orb is casted. Will Windrunner die? Yes, he casts Windrun, and he does manage to get the power shot. Nicely done by Nando, completely outplaying that Puck. Baited his over-aggressiveness. I guess Puck didn't know that, hey, Windrun has a pretty short cooldown. And, I mean, Windrunner did have enough mana to cast it a second time. So a little bit of misplay by the Puck player, and now Nando's got a very easy time. Gonna be able to pick up a bottle, just constantly refuel his mana, and just get himself a very easy lane. But reading out all the action, is gonna go on the top lane. Looks like Kunkka's taking a lot of wrestling. Here comes Weaver with the Gemini attack. Will he be able to get the last hit? Shikuchi is cooling down. He'll be able to Shikuchi in very, very soon. Will he get the last hit on the Kunkka? Will he manage to get the Shikuchi off? Yes, he does, and Kunkka's gonna be the first one to follow. Do we get a defensive disruption? No, we get an offensive disruption, and looks like Crystal Man managed to pick up the last hit with the help of the Frostbite. But here comes Sand King in with the Burrow Strike, manages to stun the Shao Demon. Shao Demon does get Frostbitten as well, and Weaver, combined with Crystal Maiden, picks up a kill. So it looks like Sentinel are stabilizing themselves in this trial lane. Sand King positioning the Burrow Strike nicely, managing to catch a couple of heroes in the initial stun, and just timing his Burrow Strike just to get the second stun as well onto that Shao Demon, allowing Weaver to pick up a very easy kill. So 716 going to be able to regain some of his farm, despite the early troubles, and now we're seeing the problem with the Scourge trial line. If you don't land the stun, and Weaver and Sand King can just constantly evade that disruption with the Burrow Strike or the Shikuchi. And Ogre does not have the innate harassment. You have the Tidebringer harassment, you have Shadow Demon harassment, but you don't have really any physical harassment by the Ogre Magi. And right now he's completely out of mana. Does anybody have a clarity for this poor, unfortunate Ogre? No, so what can he do in this trial line? Not really too much. And this is why I'm a little bit puzzled by just the offensive power by this trial. It looks like Crystal Mane does get targeted. Ogre did have enough mana to cast one Fire Blast. Manages to get that, but here comes the Swarm. Sand King gets another beautiful double Burrow Strike. So Sand King proving his way, proving wrong in this offensive trial line. And Shadow Demon's going to be a lot of trouble. Here comes Weaver in for the kill. Shikuchi manages to get that last hit. And Kuka might be in a little bit of trouble as well. Taking a lot of damage from the tower is the Weaver. But Kuka's going to have to back off. Tidebringer Slashes is just constantly wearing down the Weaver, but he does have a Ring of Health, so he's going to be able to stabilize himself in lane for quite a while. He has 6 charges on that magic stick, so it looks like this trial is going in complete favor of Mineski. Completely unexpected by my part after that first blood, but Sand King's just been doing a nice job disproving my prediction of, hey, Sand King's going to be pretty useless if he doesn't get enough levels. Unfortunately, he whiffs the Burrow Strike just there and then, but he's constantly having enough mana. He has 10 charges on that magic stick, so he can get enough mana to cast a Burrow Strike anytime he wants. And right now, Sand King getting these double Burrow Strike stuns just really proving a nuisance. And I guess this is the power of Sand King when there is no Earthshaker going to be constantly able to line himself up. Although I think Lion could serve a similar role, so I'm not really too sure why we don't see Lion. But another double Burrow Strike by a Sand King player just doing a tremendous job. CMW doing a magnificent job, but it looks like the Ogre Magi did die. No, Puck died, and it looks like Kuka's going to be the next one to fall. Sand King getting a chase off, manages to get the Burrow Strike for the last hit, and Mineski is owning already. Extremely fast-paced action. We cannot see the total kill score right now, just because I do not want to miss any action, but we did see Puck die in the bottom lane, and this Sand King, CMW just played extremely effectively right now. Ogre Magi has forced to drop a Fire Blast and just run for his life. Here comes a Shadow Poison by Shadow Demon. Is Sand King in a bit of trouble? He does not have enough mana for Sandstorm. Looks like he's going to have to run the heck away, and looks like Sand King will take the fall. Shadow Poison is going to be able to pick up the last hit. So already a lot of action on this top lane, but so far it's going in complete favor of Mineski, just because their Weaver has not died. He's picked up a Ring of Health, and he's able to control this lane quite nicely. Meanwhile, Crystal Mane has not died either, so she's going to be able to pick up a lot of experience, and meanwhile, the bottom lane winner is just completely taking advantage of this Puck. Level 5 compared to level 8, ridiculous out-leveling by Nando. Able to control the runes extremely effectively, and just able to bottle crow it up. So it's going to come down to this Invoker vs. Dragon Knight, like I mentioned earlier, and right now you can see that the Dragonite is slowly taking its toll just because of its passive Fire Breath harassment, but Meteor and Cold Snap is dropped on the Dragonite. Can he get the Sunstrike? He does have enough mana, but Invoke is probably cooling down, and looks like Dragonite is going to be able to escape after bottling up a couple of times. And right now, Invoker picked up the face with, so going to be able to out-damage the DK, and if he can just completely out-deny, out-harass the DK with his physical auto-attacks, he should be just fine. Going to be able to withstand some of the Fire Breath harassment, and just slowly but surely taking experience advantage over the Dragonite. You can see Dragonite level 7 just now, and Mio Invoker is level 7.5, so right now Dragonite is just being taken advantage of. So let's just check out the team composition. Who is going to fare better in the mid-late game stages of the game? And right now, I think Scourge has a stronger mid-game because Kunkka is pretty powerful in the mid-game, Dragonite as well. Ogre, of course, peaks in the mid-game, as well as the Shadow Demon. And meanwhile, Puck, just a mid-game monster. But right now, this early stage of the game going complete for Mineski, Swarm is casted as well. Could take a lot of damage. Soulcatcher managed to hit the Weaver, but they did not get much damage on him, and that Swarm just going to eat that Kunkka alive. It does get destroyed, but he's forced to back off. He does have the magic wand, so he's going to be able to regen up anytime he wants. And meanwhile, Sand King has migrated back. And just, it's very surprising for me to see a Sand King Crystal Mane so highly leveled in a very aggressive trial lane. But that just shows how well the Sand King has been playing with these Burrow Strikes. Constantly full mana, and looks like Shadow Demon reveals that he saw. So, right now, even though I think overall the Ledion TurboRatz has a more offensively suited mid-game lineup, as Sand King's going to come in for the Burrow Strike. Can they get the Kunkka? Here comes the Swarm and the Frostbite. Going to be able to pick up the Kunkka. Where is the Torrent? The Torrent manages to hit the Weaver. Nicely done, as Weaver's going to be able to chase and get the Shikuchi kill. Going to be able to kill Laki as well, and here comes more offensive power on the Shadow Demon. Looks like Sand King took the fall after a Fire Blast, but Ogre Magi is going to take the fall as well. And 7-1 picks up a triple kill. Meanwhile, Nando killed the Puck on the bottom lane. Everything is going Mineski's way, and this is pretty nice to see that Mineski is regaining their footing, just because Mineski has been struggling as of late in the competitive Dota 1 scene. They have fallen in regards in the Filipino scene to teams like Bad Burn, to MSI Evo GT, and to teams like iZone, but it looks like they are showing that, hey, we're starting to slowly but surely get our legs back under us. We're going to be able to pick up our slack and hopefully get on the offensive, but still, this game is long, and it's not going to be over for quite a bit. But Nando picked up that tier 1 tower. Nicely done. Let's see what Nando decides to go for. Will he go for the standard mechanism? He has 1600 gold in the bank, just completely outplaying this buck. Looks like they want to get a gank off on this Windrunner player. Will they get the disruption? Yes, they do, and they're going to be able to change some of the Fire Blast. Here comes the Fire Blast, and one more hit. Puck misses the Illusion Arrow. No, it does hit just for a blink of damage, and Ignite combined with Dream Claw. Nicely used to Dream Claw just because that's such a short cooldown, and you really want to eliminate some of Nando's complete lane dominance he had on that bomb lane. But still, that means the offensive try-in and getting Weaver a lot of farm is Mineski's side. He's already picked up his Vanguard by around the 9.5 minute mark, so he's going to be A-OK in terms of survivability. So it's going to come down to how well this DK plays, and how well the puck can pick up, how fast the puck can pick up his Blink Dagger, and how well Kunku can land his stunts. And unfortunately for him, the Sentinel side is pretty mobile, as it looks like Invoker took the fall. Sorry I missed that, but it looks like Disruption, Fire Blast, Dragon Tail managed to kill the Invoker. Ghostwalk was not invoked. He went for an Exhort Quas build. So it looks like he did have the Ghostwalk, but I guess he just did not manage to cast that fast enough. No Sentry Wards, no Dust being casted. Koka picked up Invisibility Rune. Will Mineski defend their Tier 2 tower? Looks like they're going to push the top Tier 1 tower. Mineski already has a solid advantage in regards to that. And meanwhile, the Puck player is going to be harassed continuously as Mineski is going to try to take this Tier 1 tower, get themselves a hefty gold advantage. Just checking out the overall kills, 12-5 in favor of Mineski. And the Weaver has not died, is farming pretty well. Did not get the last hit on the tower. And if there's one thing I can fault the Dota 1 players on the Filipino side, is that they do not farm very effectively, but it looks like this Weaver is just playing solidly. Picked up 5 kills, 3 assists, getting a lot of gold that way. Meanwhile, Dragonite is forced to jungle to get some of his farm back. Is he going to bottle crowed up? He's going to have to pop his bottle, and this courier is just going to have to stand a while. Stay a while and listen to the Dragonite hitting the creeps. Meanwhile, Nando might be in a lot of trouble. He's going to windrun into the trees with the help of the power shot, but right now he's just trapped himself in the corner. But one thing that this is doing is this is wasting a lot of time, but it looks like Sand King wants to join him in the midst of all this. The boat manages to hit the Windrunner. Illusor picks up the last hit as Epicenter is channeled. Looks like will Jay block out the Sand King? No, he does not. Here comes the Tiber picking up the last hit. Meteor Deafening Blast is going to be able to kill the Ogre as well. As that is it for the Ledion TurboRatz side for 2-for-1. Sand King and Windrunner. And meanwhile, Invoker picked up a kill on the Ogre Magi. Can he get a Cold Snap? He already has a 4 staff. Nice farm by Jay. Here comes a Torrent. It does hit the Invoker. Crystal Maid comes in for the support. Can she cast the Frost Nova? Sunstrike is dodged nicely by the Puck player, but he's forced to lose the orb towards the Invoker. Does die. Phase Boots and 4 staff picked up by Jay. Going to be extremely mobile, even without any points in the Wex at this stage in the game. So right now, Jay and the Mineski squad are handling themselves nicely in the mid-game, and when it comes down to late-game, I think Mineski's got it in the bag. They have Invoker, they have Weaver, they have a Windrunner, which is ridiculous late-game if he lands a Shackle Shot, and that's pretty much it. That's pretty much all you need in regards to late-game. And if Sand King picks up a pretty fast Blink Dagger, I mean, he already has Arcane Boots, which is unheard of in a Sand King in a trial, but that just shows how much assist gold he's picking up, even though he's died a couple times, 2 or 3 times. I think 3 times now, because he did give up first blood, and he died once in the top lane and died once there. And will he go on the offensive? 4 staff into a Burrow Strike. Here comes the Sunstrike. Nicely done by Jay. Ignite gonna do some damage. Looks like here comes a Dream Coil. Illusory Orb manages to pick up the last hit. RJ manages to pick up the kill on Jay instead, as Chris Main's got to run the heck away. Disruption doing a lot of damage. 716 does die. So unfortunate play for Mineski. They went a little bit too aggressively as Weaver took the fall. Meanwhile, RJ the Puck kills the Crystal Maiden with relative ease. So now I think Ledion TurboRatz saying, alright, Mineski's going to play balls to the wall. If he can get the countering game going, we have pretty short cooldowns on all of our spells. Let's just go and get it in. Meanwhile, Sand King picking up the farm. He picks up fast Blink Dagger, which is unheard of in regards to Filipino scene. Then he'll be set. I mean, he's already going to become a mid-game monster. Picks up Blink Dagger by around the 20-minute mark. Looks like they want to get a gank off on the Dragonite. But here comes Puck in for the support. Dream Call is on cooldown. And the Illusion Rune is going to just scout the Puck. Just going to scout that out. And Dragonite is going to be forced to retreat. As Strength Chance has some nice base armor already. Only 1 level of Dragon Blood, but still 9 armor is nothing you want to mess with when you don't have too much spell damage in the nearby vicinity. 15-10, 14 minutes in the game, 25 kills as they take a drink of water, and I'm sure this game is just starting to heat up in regards to all the action. Just looking at the map movement, it looks like they want to get a gank off on Weaver. Is there a smoker to see pop? No, it looks like they just want to go offensive. Will they initiate disruption? If they do that, they might give Weaver an eyeball out of time. No, they initiate with the Dragonite Dragon Tail. A nice Fire Blast manage to pick up the last hit. Is there a sentry ward? Is there a time lapse? No time lapse. Weaver, I guess it was on cooldown. A little bit puzzling. And there was a sentry ward being placed by the Scourge side. So nicely done by Ledion.TurboRatz. Now they're starting to focus more attention on the Weaver. Zitsu is getting a lot of farm 5-2 after being 5-0. So putting attention on Weaver is definitely what you want to do in regards to keeping him useless until the 30-minute mark, which is what you want to do. But still, 14 minutes in the game, and Weaver does have the Vanguard already. So they're going to have to devote a lot of resources, a lot of time. Constantly not going to get too much experience because they are forced to roam S3. To kill Weaver, and meanwhile Mineski gonna be able to farm up the other lanes, gonna keep themselves an overall experience advantage. Weaver's just gonna farm up, has Medallion of Courage already, so it's gonna be able to pump out a lot of minus armor, give his attacks a little bit more oomph in regards to the physical damage nature. Sand King just gonna farm up with Sandstorm, and looks like he wants to pick up Fast Blink Dagger, only 400 gold away, and this is the power of a Sand King when he succeeds in a challenge, but this happens so rarely that I'm still not sure this is the most effective use of Sand King. But hey, I guess if you want to get the double barrel strike, if you plan on winning the challenge, which you ideally want to do in every single Dota game you do, if you do manage to do a challenge, then I guess Sand King's a solid hero. Although he won't be level 11 until around the 20-minute mark, so that'll be a little bit disconcerting for Mineski, but still, Fast Blink Dagger with the Epicenter is no laughing matter. Meanwhile, Dragonite has picked up the Lowest Arms Edge, still not really too sure why Filipino still go for it. It gives mobility, it gives a nice form of initiation, it gives you that surprise factor. But Filipinos are starting to pick up the gem, they always have sentry wards, and I don't think Lothar's Edge is still the strongest choice, but they managed to kill Jay. Very nicely done, as Lothar's is immediately called out by the Invoker. So Jay, letting his teammates aware, saying, hey, don't let this happen to you guys. I was once initiated by a Dragonite with the Lothar's Edge and Dragon Tail. Let me tell you, that's not something I want to experience anytime soon. Unfortunately, for the Ledion.TurboRatz side, the Kunkka is not farming very well. Here comes the Lothar's Dragon Knight. Can he get the stun off on the Weaver? He's following the Weaver. Nicely done. Can he get the Dragon Tail? He does get the Dragon Tail. Is there any follow-up initiation? No, looks like Weaver will be able to escape just fine. There is a sentry ward still here. Will Weaver be caught? Yes, he does, as the Ogre casts a timely multicast, and the Fire Breath cleans up the job. So Ledion.TurboRatz, with their ganking, is going to be able to get themselves back in the game. Here comes the Epicenter, and Kunkka just managed to escape in the nick of time. Nicely done by Ledion.TurboRatz, getting themselves back in the game, 16-13. Going to be able to pick off this top tier 1 tower, and going to be able to even up the tower count, or still get themselves one tower closer to an even tower count, because they did lose tier 2 bottom tower, which is also important to the Roshan. Sand King picked up a Blink Dagger, and now Kunkka is fully aware that they do have a Blink Dagger. Gonna be able to pick up this tower with relative ease. Sand King blinks in, here comes a Deafening Blast in the mirror combination, but it misses! Can they kill the Dragonite? There is no Dust Appearance. Crystal Maiden just gonna channel his ultimate, kills the Shadow Demon, Ogre's gonna be a logical. There's the Shackle Shot for the mini stun, even if it does not latch. Looks like the multicast is gonna slow down Jay for quite a bit, but looks like Netta managed to pick up the last hit. Meanwhile, CMW takes the fall, 1-4-3, picks up the last hit. 1-4-3 was the Ogre. But CMW took the fall. He is the Sand King player, as Ogre killed the Sand King in the midst of all that. So unfortunate for the Ogre, but still 2-for-1 at a tower. Ledion.TurboRatz will take it just for the tower gold advantage, and just to slowly get themselves back in the game. But still, they did lose the Ogre. They did lose the Shadow Demon. They don't want to keep losing supports if they want to stick in the game, but they've been doing a nice job just ganking the Weaver. Weaver only level 10, even though he's been soloing it up for quite a while, just constantly using his medallion for last hits. Meanwhile, Kunkka is doing the same thing. Looks like Kunkka will be going for a late game build. He'll probably go for the Shadow Blade, aka Lothar's Edge, as Cold Snap and Jay, the Invoker player, gonna get solo ganks. Can he get the kill? Looks like he does manage to pick up the last hit. Torrent whiffs, and nice play by Jay, just being extremely active with this Invoker play, managing hit meters and Deafening Blast pretty adeptly. So nicely done by Jay. Picked up a blink dagger, extreme immobile invoker. Gonna be able to say surprise, bitches, as he managed to pick up a kill. Meanwhile, CMW takes the fall. Cannot do any sort of analysis just because there's so much chaos, so much action happening in all stages of this game. This is what you want to see in a Southeast Asian Filipino match. 34 kills in 19 minutes. Almost 2 kills per minute, and this game is slowly but surely starting to heat up as we reach the mid-games portion of the game. And just checking out the overall map positioning, looks like Mineski has a solid advantage. They have the Blink Dagger up on Sanking, which is oh so important. They have a pretty far Nando, who has 4 staff mechanism, going to be able to pick up the Necro Book pretty soon if he does go for that. Double damage Weaver with the Medallion Courage, going to be able to kill this Roshan, but here comes the Puck, going to cast the Dream Call on 2 heroes. Fire Blast, Demonic Purge, going to be able to try to pick off Jay. They cannot kill Jay. Shouting is the first one to fall. Double damage Weaver is not something you want to be very aggressive with, as here comes Ogre Magi. Will they? Koku, cast a torrent, man! Cast a torrent! Is he just going to kill the bugs? He's going to leave his Ogre to the dogs of Mineski. Unfortunate play for him. Puck is caught in the middle of nowhere. He does not have a blink dagger. Went for a mechanism instead. Pops the mechanism, trying to kill Jay, but Jay is just too tank, and Puck is going to be next in the fall. And Ledion.TurboRatz, they fought well. They fought ganking heavy, but still lack of vision in regards to this Rosh Pit, and their engagement is extremely sloppy. No sense of team coordination, so hopefully they can turn around, but they are going to give up Roshan towards the Mineski squad and giving that Weaver more survivability, especially since Ledion.TurboRatz are showing, hey, we're going to put a lot of focus on this Weaver. We're going to gank him with the Shadow Blades, aka Lothar's Edge, with the Dragonite Initiation, and this Aegis Immortal will be extremely important. But no, it goes towards Jay. Not really sure if it's his best choice just because he's so mobile with the 4th staff and Blink Dagger, but hey, I think in the mid-game he's pumping out the most damage. He's definitely the most useful hero in the mid-game until Weaver picks up the Relic. But still, Weaver has to be careful of any Dragonite initiations with the Lothar's Edge. But 15 and 22 in favor of Mineski. It looks like Weaver is about... Does he have his Relic? He picked up a Yasha, not going for the Radiance. This choice is a little puzzling just because it's still early on in the game, but still, Yasha will give you move speed, give you more survivability if you're not hexed, and he doesn't have boost speed. Meanwhile, double kill being picked up, y'all saw it, so I don't think I need to narrate it. But Dream Call, Lothar's Edge Initiation, Fire Blast, Shadow Poison. But one thing to note is that they ganked all 5, and 5 for 2, and just in regards to that exchange, Jay was healing up the fountain, so I guess they weren't getting too much experience. Mineski was in that regards. So still, things could be going worse for them. DK is going to go for that BKB, try to initiate through survivability. Is there anything on the central side that goes through BKB? Weaver right click, Sand King slow, but no damage on the epicenter. Invoker right click. So BKB will be pretty solid in regards to countering some of the sentinel damage, a lot of sentinel damage, and most of it disables the Saturn Sand King slow of the epicenter. Meanwhile, a mass push is going to go on to the bottom lane. Can the Ledion.TurboRatz squad manage to pick off this bomb tier 1 tower? Pretty important in terms of Roshan, but the bomb tier 2 tower will be more important as Jay is going to get initiated on. Here comes the Puck, does not have the Blink Dagger. Meteor Deafening Blast combination dropped, but CMW is the first one to fall. And they looks like Ledion.TurboRatz picked off that tower. They get a Shadow Shot on the Puck, and meanwhile Crystal Maiden does get Torrented. She's going to be the next one to fall for sure, as a couple last hits, and Ogre picks up the last hit on that. Meanwhile, it looks like Nando is going to be a lot of trouble. Here comes the Disruption, Soul Catcher, Shadow Poison manages to pick up the last hit. That, and Jay is going to be in a lot of trouble. The Aegis is still up on him, has a Mystic Staff, but he's going to get Chainstone down. Will he be able to escape with the Blink Dagger after the Aegis Immortal respawn? Here comes a Torrent. It does hit, and Soul Catcher just going to completely melt the Invoker. So nice return of the gank. Ledion.TurboRatz showing a lot of poise in the last engagement, just taking advantage of, hey, we have an advantage in terms of kills. We just took their tower, so we don't have a lot of tower damage, and backing them up. We'll just keep going in the offensive. We have our heroes, they're very tanky at this stage in the game, so we'll just go on a tear. And right now, Kunkka's going to teleport back to defend the lane from the Weaver. Weaver going again for the Mantis style, rather than just like a Lincoln Sphere or Radiance. I think Radiance would be a smart choice, just because it's still early on, and the Yasha is 2200 gold, so I think he would have been able to pick up the Radiance by around the 35-minute mark, had he not, if he's not going to die, but he might just die in this next engagement. Torrent does hit, nicely done, and Fire Blast cleans it up. Gem being picked up by the Ogre, the perfect gem carrier, unless, aside from the fact that he is ranged, or that he's not ranged, sorry, he has a lot of HP. a decent amount of armor, a lot of bracers, magic stick, so gem being picked up by the ogre. Checking out the kill score, it was 22-15 in favor of Mineski, and now it's 22-all. Aegis of the Moral did die, and Ledion.TurboRatz picked up a tower, so this game just swung back completely. Even if there was a gold graph, I'm sure it would have been like whoop for Mineski, and then just in the past 2 minutes. And I think it's pretty even at this point. Just checking out the overall towers, it is 4-4. So Mineski is gonna have to take this mid game slow and steady. I still believe they have the better late game, but I don't know. Weaver went for the Yasha rather than for the raids. And just to go back on the raids point, just because I keep having my thoughts cut away, just narrating some of this action. I picked up raids by the 25-minute mark. He has a Vanguard. He has a Medallion of Courage. I still think the Mineski squad should have given him the Aegis, especially since Jay just died in that last engagement. And if you pick up the Aegis and then give him the Radiance, then he'll just be able to survive, do a lot of residual damage, do a lot of damage to the Shadow Demon. But there's a couple of things that you can do in regards to counteract the raids. And one thing is just to tank up on the Scourge side, and they have tanky supports in the form of the Ogre Magi. They have a tanky Dragonite, tanky Kunkka with the Lothar's Edge as well. Shadow Demon building very tanky, Urn of Shadows with a couple of bracers, so the raids wouldn't do as much effective damage. But still, it'd be pretty useful, just causing a lot of havoc, and plus that plus 60 damage is no small feat. And it's a little bit puzzling considering how much the Filipino Weavers love that Lincoln Spear, that he went for Vanguard then Yasha rather than going for the Lincoln Spear. I'm not going to criticize it because Vanguard, of course, gives you a lot of lane stability, but since he's picked for the Vanguard, he has died multiple times, 4 times to be precise, just on the back of a lot of solid ganks. But here goes the Jane Invoker initiation. They get the Dream Call. Clicker's going to be able to cast a ship, gets a rum boost as well. He's going to be able to survive for now. Can Ledion.TurboRatz turn this team fight around? Sanking is stunned. He could not get his ultimate off. Looks like Sanking might be the first one to fall. Oh, 16 Dragonite casting so much damage as multicast being casted as well as the Ledion.TurboRatz squad is forced to retreat. Kunkka survives so much damage. The rum certainly helped out as Mitch casts the ship. So nicely done by Ledion.TurboRatz, taking advantage of Mineski's solid initiation in the form of the Invoker, but unfortunately Sanky could not follow up, and we are forced to teleport back to the bomb lane. Still no boots. It's not like he needs it. He has Yasha to give him a little bit of bonus move speed in that regard. But hey, solid play nonetheless by Ledion.TurboRatz. Now they have the kill lead as well, and they are slowly but surely gaining the momentum. I still maintain they have the stronger mid-game lineup, and if the game goes into the late season of the game, Mineski will be in a lot of trouble. But still, it's a little bit disconcerting considering Mineski had such a solid lead. They won their lanes very effectively, looked in a prime position to slaughter the mid-game on the back of their Farm Invoker and Windrunner. And fortunately, they have just not been working out. Their initiation is not performing very admirably at all. Necrobook is the item being picked up by the Windrunner, as completely expected. Meanwhile, Crystalmane Tranquility Boots, or Boots of Tranquility, with the Urn of Shadow, is going to give her a little bit more tankability and armor with that little bit of regen as well. We were getting close to that Manta style. Let's just check out some of the farm on the opposing side. Can we do that? Well, I guess we're just going to have to go the old-fashioned way. Ogre has 1k gold in the bank. DK, 400 gold. Shadow Demon, 500 gold. Kunkka, 400 gold. I think I just said that. Puck had that Blink Dagger, 400 gold as well. So, looks like Ledion.TurboRatz spent all their gold. Lothar's Edge on the Kunkka. Drums being picked up by the Ogre. Nice purchase for the Ogre Magi. Gonna be able to zip around the map. DK has just picked up his farm so intensely. I'm sure he has around 200 CS by this point. Probably not 200 CS, sorry. He's picked up a lot of kills. 200 CS by 28 mark. That's a pretty Chinese farm. And considering that this DK has been in a lot of battles, and he's farmed pretty effectively, I don't think he's picked up 200 CS, so I guess a lot of that just coming from the fact that they're winning a lot of battles recently. Picked up the Hyperstone and the BKB. Puck pick up the Blink Dagger and the Mechanism. And Mechanism is pretty good in Puck just because he's going to be in the middle of everything for a while with the Phase Shift and the Blink Dagger. But still, a Puck you want to get in and out. And if you're out of the battle with the Illusory Orb and the Ethereal Jaunt and the Blink Dagger combination, then you're not going to be able to be in position, even though the Mechanism has a ridiculous AoE. I think it's like 700 AoE around your allies. Pretty ridiculous. Like, Mechanism, if you pop it here, it'll go all the way up to here. Pretty ridiculous item. So I'm surprised there's no piping working just to counteract some of that Sandking stun. But I guess they're just going to initiate with the Lothar's Edge and just kill the Sandking, because he did not get his ultimate off in that last engagement. Jay, does he have a TP scroll? He does, still has a Mystic Staff to work with. But Mio and Scourge are threatening for that middle tier 2 tower. If they pick it up, no more easy Roshan access for the Sentinel squad. Ogre Magi getting nuked down, but it looks like Windrunner gets nuked. Four Staff going to be able to push him away. Dreamcall only casts on one hero. Nando was the first one to fall, but it looks like RJ the Puck did die in that exchange towards Jay. Sorry. As my throat was clogged up for a little bit, but here comes Dragonite just doing so much damage. Dragonite becoming such a threatening force. These Frosty Dragon is throwing on so much Ice Breath. It would be pretty cool if Dragonite had the same Freezing Breath like in the Warcraft 3 version. But Sandking looks in with a huge epicenter. Shouting Union is going to melt in the midst of all that, but Sandking's going to be the first one to fall. That gem just proving its weight in... is worth its weight in gold at the moment. It's 2 for 2, but all the while, keep in mind that Ledion.TurboRatz did pick off that middle tier 2 tower. Meanwhile, Weaver's going to come in. Can he snipe the Ogre Magi? If they kill the Ogre Magi and get the gem, that would be pretty huge for Mineski. They do get the Ogre Magi, and Crystal Maiden picks up the gem. Nicely done, immediately spotting the gem, and going to be able to kill that. And now Dragonite, his Elder Dragon form, times out at the worst time. Kunkka can cast a defensive torrent to save his allies. Gem is up, but looks like Kunkka will be able to escape. Just going to go vroom, like he's on his own boat with the Lothar's Edge, and they are not going to catch up to him. Haste Rune is on the ground. Weaver's going to try to pick it up. Yes, he does manage to pick it up. Kunkka managed to get back in position. Now Kunkka is going to die. A little bit unfortunate play by Leki. I think if he just kept going, Chris Main would not be able to catch up, and he'd be able to pop Lothar's Edge one more time. So a little bit of mistake by Leki. So Ledion.TurboRatz was not even exchanged 4 for 2 in the midst of all that, even though they did get 2 kills and a tier 2 tower. But at least Dragonite did not die, and that's better than nothing. And they kill the tower. That's alright. Can Mineski pick off this Roshan? Will they give the Aegis to the Weaver? He has a Mantis style finish, not much mana in the bank, but he does have 14 charges on his magic wand. Meanwhile, Jay has the Hex. He's just been doing so much damage with these tornadoes into deafening blasts, and he's been dropping ice walls and cold snaps, so he's using a lot of invoker's tools. Dragonite's gonna try to initiate, but he does have the gem. But meanwhile, he's forced to pop the BKB, already less than half HP. He does have Mask of Death as well to get him some lifesteal, but still, with the BKB popped and the Dragonite form slowly but surely ticking away, keep minus 55 second cooldown after it is expired. So it's a pretty short cooldown in regards to ultimate, but still, you want to take a team fight when you have the full duration. Looks like Invoker picks up the Aegis, just going to force staff his way out of there. Sandking comes in with the Epicenter. They kill the Dragonite immediately. Nicely played by CMW. It looks like Nen to pick up a tower in the midst of all that. And Ogre Magi is going to be next one to fall. Oh no, it's all going wrong for Ledion.TurboRatz, as here comes the ship going to hit two heroes, as they're going to be able to pick off RR, the Crystal Maiden, and the Weaver player as well. How'd they kill the Weaver? I did not see. Maybe on the back of the boat. Ogre Magic comes in. Nice play by CMW. Here comes a Hack Shackle Shot going to be able to kill the Ogre Magi and Brown, and they're going to kill the Kunkka as well. Jay with the Aegis, the Immortal, doing so much damage, and just ridiculous play by the Sandking and Nana with the Hack Shackle Shot. Ridiculous play by the Mineski squad in regards to how well that shaped up for them at the end. It was looking bad, it was looking grim, but Mineski managed to turn it around. Nando has the Necrobook level 3, so going to be able to push towers very, very quickly. Has a gem and the True Sight by the Necrobooks as well for the Sand King. Point booster as well, so he's going to get pretty tanky. Level 16 ultimate is not something you want to sneeze at around the 40 minute mark. Hey, it's pretty solid. If they pick up this tier 3 tower, Ledion.TurboRatz is going to be a lot of trouble, and they are going to kill this. Puck going to blink in, going to get hexed as well. Can Mineski chain stun him down? Here comes the Burrow Strike and the Mana Burn. Puck is going to be the next one to fall. And Jay did die. He lost the Aegis, but looks like the Ledion.TurboRatz side are going to lose their Rex. So Aegis for Rex, something you'll take any day of the week. So, if there's one thing you have to fault Ledion.TurboRatz on, is that they do not know how to take Roshan teamfight engagements. Just because the last two Roshan teamfight engagements have just gone completely in favor of Mineski. It's been like 4-2 and 5-2, or just 4-1. So, looks like Jay might be in a lot of trouble, but no detection up on the Ledion.TurboRatz squad, and Jay is just very high leveled, using all the tools, Deafening Blast. Here comes the Torrent, gonna kill the Weaver. Weaver just not having a good time, time lapses out. Here comes the X and the Disruption, can they catch the Torrent? Here comes the Soul Catcher as well, gonna be able to kill this Weaver with the help of the Soul Catcher and the Sentry Ward. And now you're gonna go on the offensive with the Crystal Maiden. Why do the Pinoy players just always stick around? It's gonna mean for some epic plays. But here comes a huge Shackle Shot by Nano, but now he might be in a lot of trouble. Here comes the Hex by Jay, as the Meteor is gonna blast down, rain havoc upon everybody. The ship does hit as the Fire Blast manages to catch Nano in place. Can they get the last hit? Kunkka going in for the kill, and he's slowed by as well. Nice play by Jay, but looks like Crystal Maiden did die to the Ogre Magi, and meanwhile, Brown did suicide to the neutral creeps as Lakee. The Kunkka player did manage to pick up the kill, as the chasing is just going in favor of the Mineski squad. It's too much havoc carrying on, epicentering being channeled just with the Kunkka. Nicely done by CMW level 16. Now Kunkka buys back, knowing that, hey, we do not want to give up this advantage that we had in that last team fight. Let's try to push out the lanes, get the creep equilibrium back on our side, and just slowly but surely get ourselves back into the game. But right now, Mineski has a lot of momentum, 33 to 31. 2 kills per minute, 64 kills total. So much action in this game. And now we're seeing why it's recommended replay. Not the prettiest game. A lot of mistake engagements and... Okay. This is what I see often in the Filipino games. Why, when, you know, Crystal Maiden's dying, or Windrunner is dying, or Sand King's dying, or Invoker's dying, well, I guess if Invoker's dying, a minor hero's dying, you know, their teammates just stick around and just stay in near the engagement, even though that teammate's dying and there's four people there. Not really too sure why the teammates stick around, but it looks like the Sand King player is going to be Miwato, going to give up the gem as well. Ogre going to be happy to reclaim that. He's saying, this is my gem originally, bitch. I want it back. It's going to look good for my Ogre lady friends if I win this game later. And now Ledion.TurboRatz trying to desperately gain the momentum. They've been doing a nice job in terms of ganking and chasing, but the team fights are not going their way. They are not looking very composed in regards to team fights. But let's see if they can turn it around. Weaver has been dying so much, has met style, still no boots. Going for the boots spilled. I'd like to see him pick up some treads at the very least, just because I guess some move speed is better than nothing. Is he just going to go bootsless for the entire game? That might just be his agenda. Say, hey, survivability and damage is going to be more important as Shikuchi. That's all I need. But meanwhile, Helm of the Dominator, Selkirus for the Dragonite. Does Kunkka pick up any items? Kunkka has the Ogre Axe, which is an axe in this game. It's going to go for that BKB. Shout even has not made any item progression. Neither has the Ogre Magi. Has the... Puck. Puck has not... But he's picked up phase boots. Here comes the MP. It is dodged for the most part. Dragonite did lose a hefty chunk of mana. Did sell his bottle. Unless he's still bottle crowing it up. Which I would not doubt it. But now leading to rats, can they get the team fight engagement that they want? Meteor being dropped so early on just to delay the push. But keep in mind, Meteor has a 70 second cooldown. But that Wex Path making it travel for such a far distance. Jay is just extremely high leveled. Level 21 Invoker is not something you want to mess with. Has a Soul Booster, gonna go for the Bloodstone, gonna give him a lot of mana regen to spam all of that spells. Meanwhile, Puck is getting initiated on. Here comes the Dragonite, just popped his Dragon Form. Still no BKB popped. Here comes the Boat, it does not hit anything, gonna give him some damage reduction. As Nando is gonna need a lot of trouble, gets Dream Cold and X. Here comes the Soul Catcher, Demonic Purge. Gonna do a lot of damage, but Nando is just refusing to die. Can Nando escape? Will Nando escape? He's gonna try to run through the trees of a Puck, gonna keep chasing, and he's gonna die to the poison of the Shao Dune, but still, Weaver just being so annoying that's top lane. Ogre's supposed to teleport back, and now Weaver is forcing teleportations back. Ledion.TurboRatz is not going to be able to push it into the middle barracks just because they're forced to defend this top lane. Nice play by this Weaver player by 716. Gonna force TP scrolls and stop that push, even though they lost two heroes. Ledion.TurboRatz is forced to go on the defensive, and now Dragonite caught in the middle of nowhere. He still has a Dragon Form, so he has the increased movement speed. Shout even gonna have Dragonite's back, saying, I got you, buddy. But now the Dragonite Form is gonna be cooling down for the next 50 seconds. Will Mineski make their move? Two heroes are still cooling down in regards to their death timer. So we'll see what Mineski decides to do. Any item progression? Does Kunkka have BKB yet? Let's just check out his gold really quickly. Looks like he just bought something. Is it a fish BKB? We shall see. I'm going to sell the bracer. No, He does not have a BKB just yet. I guess a little bit more farm until he finishes that. Let's just check out the item progression. Again, Invoker going for the Bloodstone. If he goes for a very fast Aghanim Scepter, it'll be complete worth it. Just all the mana to spam everything. And hey, Refresher's not out of the question either if you go for this build. Gonna get a lot of mana regen through that. But still, it takes a lot of late game. And I guess Mineski's anticipating Weaver's not really doing too much. We just have to turtle it up for a bit. And Jay was gonna have to try to carry us through the mid to late stages of the game. But looks like Ledion.TurboRatz, they do not like to smoke, but they just like to go charging in. I guess they see smoke as a waste of money. But looks like the ward match catch Ledion.TurboRatz out of position. Will they maneuver into position? Shadow Demon gets mana burn, and a swarm does manage to hit on a couple of heroes. 3,000 cast range on that swarm. Puckcon in the middle of nowhere manages to get a nice group call. Crystal Maiden might be the first one to die. We are getting stunned and slowed. Gonna be able to cast a time lapse. Gonna try to get away, but no, he just gets back in the middle of the Dragonite. Gonna get nuked down by the Fire Blast. And now Invoker's gonna be a lot of trouble. Blinks away from the last attack of the Dragonite, and Sand King's gonna try to blink away. Yes, he manages to escape just for now, as looks like Nando's going to teleport back in. Mineski on full retreat, the last three chases slash teamfights going in Ledion.TurboRatz's way, as Dragonite has a Bloodlust. I thought for a moment he popped his BKB, but no, he has a Bloodlust, going to be able to kill this tier 2 tower, and they might even be able to push into Rex. No, the Dragonite form is going to expire very soon, but hey, keep in mind, 55 second cooldown, it's going to be up pretty soon in that regard as well. Meanwhile, Jay and CMW managed to kill Brown, the Shaodian player, in the midst of all that. Do not know how that happened. The middle top, the range Rex did fall, so Ledion.TurboRatz gonna have to stall their push for a little bit until Shaodian respawns, until the creep equilibrium is in their favor. But still, they've got to be feeling reasonably well, considering they've won the last two team fights convincingly. So how will Mineski respond? I guess not really convincingly. They've taken 2 to 3 heroes, and they've lost 1 or 2. But still, they've won the team fights, which is more than Mineski can say. At least Mineski can say, ah, we got a Rex, what you gonna do about it? It might come down to the next Roshan. In terms of Roshan engagements, Mineski has just had the upper hand. And just in terms of the warding, Mineski having a lot of wards up on their side of the map. Meanwhile, Ledion.TurboRatz has nothing. Again, Ledion.TurboRatz not buying many smoker deceits, but still charging in, just taking advantage. Alright, we have better survivability, and we're killing the Weaver a lot. Weaver is just not becoming any sort of presence, and this is why I'm not really too sure about Weaver in the Filipino scene. Just not really being too effective, just needs too much farm, and considering the massive amount of spell damage and the chain stunning abilities, and definitely the Filipinos have improved their chain stunning abilities. I remember like a year ago, I think Luminous was harping on the fact that the Filipinos did not chain stun well, but now they're able to kill Weavers with relative ease, so definitely the Filipino Dota 1 scene alive and strong and still improving in the midst of all that, but still. In terms of decision making, in terms of just sticking around a little bit too long, gonna fault them on that. But they make for very entertaining games, and keep in mind all these players are a billion times better than me. So all this criticism is just from an objective stand of view. And keep in mind, I haven't watched too much Chinese Dota 1. Maybe the Chinese Dota 1, you know, they do not play as well as they did before because they're playing for Dota 2 as well. So we'll see. Looks like the Scourge are going to go in for the Roche, but they have the natural Roshan advantage. But keep in mind, the Weaver player 716 is constantly pushing that top lane. And now Ledion.TurboRatz is going to have to back the heck away. Kunkka is going to die with the Necro 3 being popped. Shackle Shot. Here comes the Dream Call. Does not catch the Sand King. Can they get the Fire Blast? Yes, they do. Nando going to be in auto. Nando's going to melt immediately. Dragonite pops the form. Can they go on the offensive for the Sand King? They get the Purge off, and the Shadow Poison is going to disable that Blink Dagger. Fire Blast. Here comes the Sandstorm. Can he escape? No. As looks like Puck's going to blink in. Going to be able to follow. Sand King's going to be in auto. 2-for-1 in that exchange again. So Ledion.TurboRatz getting themselves back in the game. But it looks like Nando bop back and got a kill. No, he didn't buy back. How did Nando pick up a kill? Not too sure. as Ogre picks up the HC Immortal. Who picked up the cheese? Looks like Jay picked up the cheese. He's going to be out to pop it extremely soon. Has the Bloodstone. Will he pop the cheese right about now? He will not. He's going to force staff himself away. Nice jukes by Jay, but he's going to die. He pops the cheese before Dragonite can get the last hit off. And now Jay is going to have to get the heck out of there. And now Ogre Magic is going to force through cheese. He does have a gem, but he does lose it as well. He had the Aegis. Crystal Man picks up the cheese. These Roshan engagements. Ledion TurboRatz just need to get their Roshan teamfights under control because they are not working out, and this might be the end. Will Jay go on the offensive? He does cast the Ice Wall. Does Dragonite have buyback? I cannot tell, but he pops the Lethar's Edge. Going to be able to survive. It looks like Jay wants the Tier 4 towers rather than any sort of racks. Going to be able to claim at least one Tier 4 tower. Meanwhile, Weaver is going to say, ha, I'm doing something, guys. I'm hitting a tower. He managed to pick up BKB in the midst of all that, so he's going to be able to survive some of the burst damage. Meanwhile, that Tidebreaker Slash is doing half HP to Jay. Going to cast the X Torrent, but the Force Staff, the Torrent still managed to hit, so Jay is going to be slowed down, but the Tier 4 towers are going to be in full breach, so they are going to die. Shackle Shot hits two heroes. Huge Shackle Shot by Nano. Can they get the kill? Dragonite's going to be the next one to fall. The boat managed to catch one hero, the Invoker, as Dragonite's going to be able to escape just barely. Dragonite felt that would be the end of the game. Kunkka's going to be able to survive. Can Mineski kill this throne? That is the real question. They're focusing a lot of damage. All their heroes relatively healthy. Dreamcrawl catches two heroes. That's the puck going to try to escape. Dragonite gets the initiation, but not full HP. Did not full the heal the full amount as we were going to try to kill the Dragonite. Medallion of Courage doing a lot of damage. Dragonite, can he escape? He does get four stacked back into the fountain. Jay buys back. Will he teleport in with the Boots of Travel? No, he's just going to walk back out as Nando dies in the midst of all that. Crystal Man going to die as well. Going to lose the gem again, but now Ledion TurboRatz in a lot of trouble. Looks like we were going to try to kill this tower, and I do not know if as a regen, the creeps are not in the base. Looks like the Mantle Illusions will kill the tower as the gem is picked up by the Ogre Magi. Weaver in a lot of trouble. Weaver is going to take the fall. He does die to the Dragonite player. So, nicely done, but still, the Roshan teamfights are what's killing Ledion TurboRatz when they look back on the replay. If they look back on the replay, they're going to be like, guys, what are these Roshan teamfights? We had this game in the bag, we have so much momentum, and then these Roshan fights, we just fall apart, but still, they're gonna have to be on the lookout. The Weaver always pushing that top lane, a lot of mobility up on the Sentinel squad. And meanwhile, Sand King channels the Epicenter, trying to kill the Shaolin. Shaolin, pretty tanky, he's gonna survive all of it. One more pulse, a little picked up the kill. Urn of Shadow is going to try to heal up the Shaolin. Will Sand King get the blink in? Shadow Poison just to keep disabling the blink dire at Demonic Purge, and Shaolin is going to be able to escape. And now Sand King, it looks like Jay managed to pick up the last hit with the Sunstrike. Did not catch the Sunstrike, but still, that was the only way Jay could have picked up a kill. And now Sand King is going to be all trouble. Crystal Man, why are you killing my cameraman? As the Fire Blast Shaolin in exchange for the Sand King. Considering Sand King uses ultimate, pretty even exchange. Shadow Demon has a shorter cooldown on his ultimate and pretty useful in terms of counter pushing with the Shadow Poison, getting more illusions of his Dragon Knight. So I'd call that an even exchange at this stage of the game. You know, Nando has two boots. Should probably sell his phase. Just a suggestion. Only plus 24 damage. Sell your boots, buddy. Does he have any gold? 1600 gold. You might be able to pick up a Ghost Scepter or something. I think selling your phase boots would be a wise decision. Yo, Crystal Mane, ridiculous. Not really ridiculously stacked. Until you see a Hex on Crystal Mane or a BKB, she is not ridiculously stacked. She is stacked in more ways than one, but not in this game, as EMP Tornado just constantly pushing away Jay. But Jay might be caught in position, might pay for his foolishness with his life. Torn X combination mistimed. Poor play by the Kunkka, but still going to be able to pick off Jay. Does he have buyback? He does indeed have buyback. Level 25. Actually, I'm not really too sure if he does have buyback. I think he should have buyback, considering I don't know. Well, he did just buyback, so he might not. But now the creep Equilibrium is in favor of Mineski. Going to be forced to defend. And considering Jay did not immediately buyback, and he does have the Bloodstone, so he's going to be able to respawn relatively quickly. Meanwhile, Satanic DK being called out by Jay. So we'll see how Mineski decides to approach this. Actually, more important, we'll see how Ledion TurboRatz decides to approach this. Considering they have not much momentum, as Windrunner is going to continuously push these middle racks. Going to be able to pop the Focus Fire, kill this Tier 3 tower. Will Ledion TurboRatz suicide for the mid rax? Gonna lose a rax in exchange. Not really too sure if it's the best choice. Looks like Nando's like, what am I doing killing these bomb racks, guys? Let's go hit the throne. Throwing 15 armor, but still, slowly but surely, gonna try to kill that down. I guess they're counting on the fact that Nando cannot kill the rax fast enough, but if the Ledion TurboRatz side gets chased on Nando, we'll be able to kill the throne, as two teleportations in Shadow Demon and the Ogre are gonna be able to kill. Meanwhile, CMW did take the fall. So, Sand King, Bajazak, Alice does Nando. Can they kill the middle Rex in the midst of all this Satanic on the DK? Will he pop the BKB? Will he get the lifesteal up? He's going to get Shackle Shot. Beautiful chain stuns by Mineski. Can they kill this DK? Will he get the Satanic off? No, gets tornadoed up in the air. And he will take the fall. Just too much chain stunning. BKB did not even have a chance to be popped. Two kills being picked up by Mineski. Going to kill this Kunkka as well. Does DK have buyback? DK, tell me a buyback, man. Tell me a buyback. He does not have buyback, and this will be the end. Unless Mineski just falls apart. Fairy Dragon, Bajazak, what can you do? You are a puny dragon. Puny dragon cannot defend the throne against the onslaught of this Mineski squad. No, they're going to get the chase. Nice baiting. Going to stall every bit of time until the DK respawns. But Ogre is going to die. Ogre, a pretty important hero this late in the game, 6 second cooldown on the Fire Blast, and he has a Bloodlust to buff up his carries. Meanwhile, it looks like the creepy equilibrium is just going to be constantly pushed away. Mineski, why aren't you just killing the throne, guys? Kunkka manages to buy back, but still, Kunkka. That ain't a giant frosty dragon, just saying that right off the bat. As Weaver's going to try to kill this top barracks, has a couple of blades of alacrity, just getting a lot of agility. He's not going to go to Piece of Blade. Just looks like he's going to pick up as much damage and armor before forfeiting this game. DK just managed to buy back in the midst of all that, so DK is going to be able to save the throne for a little bit, but the top barracks did fall, and now the Necrobooks and Nando are going to try to kill these bottom barracks as well. Mega Creeps will mean the end, considering Mineski's just been able to keep their mobility up. The range Rex does fall, and now they're going to have to make a choice to defend the throne or defend the Rex. And in the midst of all that, Ledion managed to pick up a kill on Crystal Maiden, but hey, meanwhile, Weaver's duking out mono e mono against the DK and realizes, hey, I'm just a little bug. I can't take on a giant dragon. But it looks like Mineski's not focus firing the important buildings. Jay's like, guys, what are you doing? This is how you do it. I'm going to show you how it's done. Going to blink in, going to kill this top barracks. No, one more hit, Jay. One more hit, buddy. There we go. As the boatman just hit Jay, is gonna die. They might be able to stall the Mega Cruise, but still, once the Aegis and Cheese respawn, do not see too much hope for Ledion TurboRatz, considering they have so much mobility. Nando constantly pushing in with the Necrobooks. And still, I mean, Ledion TurboRatz put a lot of time investing, gonna try to hold on to this game as long as possible. But Kunkka, again, just not shaping up as expected. Sunstrike gonna whiff on the Kunkka player. But those lava spawns just doing way too much damage. Those minus armor ticks gonna be able to pick up a kill. Meanwhile, 716, the Leader player managed to kill the Shadow Demon. And now Ledion TurboRatz are gonna have to retreat. Ha ha ha, being called out by the Kunkka player. Feeling a little bit sheepish that he did die to the Shadow, or to the lava spawns. Meanwhile, DK gonna try to duke it out with the Dragon Knight. And the throne is going to fall towards Nando, and the endless focus fire of the single glaive thrower. The creep's going to get a couple last hits, and the throne does fall. So here comes the final score screen, so we can finally check out the farm. I did say DK had 200 CS, and before I retracted that statement, he has around 300 CS at the end. You can just see all the farms in the game. But Mineski managed to hold on after an innumerable amount of momentum swings, so nicely done by Mineski, showing that, hey, in the late stages of the game, we have the experience, we have the power, we have the power, He-Man style. So managed to hold on and get this game. Still, the Roshan fights, and the fact that DK did not save enough money for buyback. I think in that engagement, normally I'm a fan of, okay, you know, Filipino style is not to save for buyback, so it's alright. He did buyback, but it might have been a little bit too little too late. And considering the focus firing of the Mineski squad, just managed to take every single Roshan team fight, Ledion TurboRatz have to feel a little bit discouraged, and I just have to start faulting the picks a little bit. Not really the faulting, just criticizing some of the picks. Weaver did not really do too much. Konka, not really too sure what the appeal is. He has not been winning at all, even when he's compared with the Shaladin. They did not even manage to win their lane, which is the whole point of the Konka Shaladin lane. Soul Catcher and Notorious is such a deadly combination. So I'm hoping that either they utilize Konka more efficiently, or they just stop picking Konka because he's not working out at all. But we will see. I guess the X just pretty useful in terms of chasing. X managed to kill a lot of heroes, especially the Weaver. But if I had to give a couple MVPs, it would be Jay, just because he managed to play very magnificently. Sanking in laning stages, managed to constantly get Burrow Struck. But aside from that, I don't think many players played very perfectly or just very magnificently. Ogre played solidly. I think DK played solidly. Still not really understanding the appeal of Lothar's Edge, but still, you know, the initiation and the backstabs cannot be underestimated, and that movement speed bonus. But we will see. Definitely an interesting game. Unfortunately, I do not know if I'll be bringing you any more Dota 1 games in the near future until GST July, just because there aren't too many games. If there's a Jay vs. Jules show match replay upload, if there's more, you know, solid games. But still, I have other projects to be working on, so thank you all for watching. And send me replays, as always, if you want to see Dota 1 matches. Bebon773@gmail.com. Follow me on Twitch, follow me on Twitter, Facebook. So thanks for watching, and have a fantastic day.